Hello students, hope in the previous video you people have learnt on different types of probability distributions that you come across in discrete random variables. So there are two types which we have learnt. One is binomial and the other one is Poisson distribution. Now let us learn on continuous probability distribution, or which comes the probability distribution which is related to continuous random variable. So now let me tell you one more caution here. You people come across with quite a number of expressions for probability density function here. So there is no derivation part here. You people should remember this particular density functions. You have to somehow you have to remember it. You need to go through it and you should keep it in mind. Okay, now coming to Gaussian or normal distribution in a continuous random variable exercise. So what is Gaussian or normal distribution here is, a random variable x is said to have a normal distribution if its probability density function is given by, f of x equals 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi multiplied by the exponential power of e to the power of minus half into x minus mu the sigma whole square. Okay, so here the two main parameters for defining the probability density function in a Gaussian normal distribution is, one is the mu, which is mean, which is e of x, and the other one is the variance, which is sigma square. I hope this mu and sigma square, if you remember, we have learnt long back in video 2 or video 3 of my lecture, and we have learnt in detail about what is mean and what is variance. So you should go back and recall those concepts here. Okay, so using that mean and variance, we have defined the probability density function for a Gaussian or a normal distribution in terms of continuous random variable x. So here in this formula, you can see x is varying between minus infinity to plus infinity. Similarly, mean value will also vary from minus infinity to plus infinity, and variance should always be greater than zero. This is one of the popular Gaussian, one of the popular probability distribution that we actually use even in communication field, where while finding out the probability of error for any communication modulation techniques, in digital modulation techniques especially, we normally go with this Gaussian or normal distribution. So here in Gaussian or normal distribution, before that, let us see what is continuous random variable. If you recall, it is an uncountable number of values that we get, right? So that is what the continuous random variable definition is all about, which is not countable. So we cannot list the possible values because there is an infinite number of them. So as it is not countable, definitely we cannot list the possible values. So as we have infinite number of values, the probability of each individual values is virtually zero. The probability of each individual values is virtually zero. Very important point which you people are reading here or you're listening here. As we have infinite number of values, because of continuous random variable which is uncountable, the probability of each individual value is virtually zero. Now, because there is an infinite number of values, the probability of each individual value is virtually zero. Therefore, we can determine the probability of range of values only. So you can find out the probability of range of values, but you can't find out for all those infinite number of values. So that is what you should keep in mind. So example, with the discrete random variables like tossing a die, it is meaningful to talk about P of x equals 5, right? So if you take a discrete random variable like tossing a die, you can easily talk about P of x equals 5 because it is countable. But in a continuous setting, the probability, the random variable of interest, say task length or takes exactly 5 minutes, is infinitesimally small, hence P of x equals 5 equals 0. Means task length takes exactly 5 minutes, and 5 minutes in a continuous random variable, as it is infinite, then 5 minutes definitely will be infinitely very small. So when you take very smaller value, then probability of those smaller value will definitely be equal to zero. That is the reason why I've said you the probability of each individual value will virtually become zero when you take continuous random variables. So therefore, in continuous settings, it is meaningful to talk about P of x is less than or equal to zero. Not exactly x equals 5. you should take with p of x is less than or equal to 5. Okay, now probability density function, normally f of x, when you take function f of x, which is a probability density function, if you see a draw a curve for that particular probability density function, we go with range where x is greater than or equal to a or less than or equal to b. So if you try to draw the graph for that, you can see this area equals 1 between a equals a and b. So that graph is much clear for you because we are going to take a range. So the first point here is f of x is greater than or equal to 0 for all x between a and b. That is first thing you should keep in mind. The total area under the curve between a and b is always equal to 1. Okay. Now coming to continuous distribution. So in continuous distribution, you can see an area is being taken between 40 and 60. So this graph gives the students getting grade greater than 40 and less than 60. So the overall marks is 100 is the grade that students should take. So in that you try to take the range of 40 to 60. So that is what you consider an area for. Always the continuous distribution will always be with respect to the range or with respect to the particular area that you take in continuous distribution. So here the normal distribution, this is how the graph looks for normal distribution. So the probability density function of a normal random variable would be given by an expression which we have seen earlier, where this expression will yield a graph which will be bell-shaped like this. So it is called a bell-shaped symmetrical around the mean. So here this is the mean value that you have, and you can see both left side of the mean and right side of the mean, you can see the graph which is symmetric to each other. Therefore it is symmetrical around the mean is what you can see. Okay, so you get a bell-shaped symmetrical around the mean graph for a probability density function of a normal random variable. Now how to vary this graph, how to make variations in this graph. So which are the two values that you are going to vary so that you can vary the distribution among different values in the graph? One thing is you need to vary the variance sigma. The other thing you need to vary is the mean value mu. So mu and sigma are the two values which you actually vary. So that is what you can see in this particular slide. Changing mu shifts the distribution left or right, whereas changing variance increases or decreases the spread. So you can elaborate the spread. The spread can be elaborated by changing the value of variance, whereas you can shift the graph left or right by varying the value of mu. So therefore the properties of normal distribution, if you come across with, the first property is bell-shaped. So it is a bell-shaped symmetrical to x-axis. So we call it as mesocurtic. So bell-shaped symmetric to x-axis, we call it as mesocurtic. Asymptotic to x-axis, it is continuous, unimodal, the area will be equal to 1. So the formula for area is integration of minus infinity to plus infinity f of x dx will be equal to 1. Sixth is you have only two parameters. Seventh is probability between the intervals equals area on curve between the interval. Eighth is mean equals mode equals median will be at center. So mean, mode, median, all three are same. So will be at center. So coming to the next slide. So the normal distribution density function, as I said you earlier, it is dependent on two different values. One is this sigma, the other one is this mu. Okay. So this is a bell-shaped curve with different centers and spread depends on mu and sigma. So note this constant pi value is 3.14159 and this e value is 2.71829. Anyway, this pi and e you can get easily in the calculator, so you need not too much, and you know it already, which you people have already seen in mathematics. So here, if you take mean variance and standard deviation, so if I take mean variance and standard deviation, so the mean for normal distribution is given by integration of minus infinity to plus infinity x of 1 over rho into square root of 2 pi into e power minus half x minus mu by rho sigma the whole square. So this is x into f of x dx. That is what. the mean equals integration of minus infinity to plus infinity x into f of x dx, where f of x is nothing but this formula which we have seen earlier. Similarly, variance of x equals sigma square, which is equal to integration of minus infinity to plus infinity x square into f of x dx. So x square into f of x dx into minus variance equals integration of minus infinity to plus infinity x square into f of x into dx minus mu square, so minus e of x the whole square. I hope if you remember earlier, for variance we have a formula. What is that? E of x square minus e square of x. So e of x square is nothing but integration of minus infinity to plus infinity x square f of x dx minus e square of x. So it is mu square. Standard deviation is nothing but square root of variance, which is equal to sigma. So if you take standard normal distribution, so there is one, something called a standard normal distribution. A normal distribution whose mean is 0 and standard deviation is 1 is actually called a standard normal distribution. Keep this in mind, very very important. If you have sigma equals 1 and the mean value mu equals 0, then that condition or that type of distribution is normally called as standard normal distribution. So if you substitute 1 for sigma and 0 for mu, you will be ending up with f of x equals 1 over square root of 2 pi into e power minus x square by 2. Because this is 0, therefore x square will be left out within this bracket. Therefore you get 1 over 2 pi into e power minus x square by 2. That is the formula for the probability density function for a standard normal distribution. So the standard normal distribution, all normal distributions can be converted into standard normal curve by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. So all normal distributions can be converted into standard normal curve by subtracting the mean. So you are subtracting the random variable x with mean and you are dividing that with the standard deviation, which is sigma. Sigma square is variance, whereas sigma is nothing but standard deviation. So you take x minus mu divided by sigma, which is equal to z. This formula can convert any normal distribution into standard normal distribution or curve. So therefore, as I said you earlier, this is the formula that you get for standard normal distribution or standard normal probability density function, which is equal to 1 over square root of 2 pi e power minus half into z square. So you are calculating the normal probabilities. Now let us take an example. The time required to build a computer is normally distributed with a mean of 50 minutes and a standard deviation of 10 minutes. What is the probability that a computer is assembled in a time between 45 and 60 minutes? So algebraically speaking, what is probability of x greater than 45 and less than 60? So x is between 45 and 60. Now you need to find out what would be the probability that a computer is assembled in a time between 45 and 60. So here mean value is given, which is 50 minutes, and standard deviation is given to be 10. So it means that mu equals 50 and sigma equals 10. Solution. Let us find out the solution for this. So we know that the standard normal distribution is given in terms of formula z equals x minus mu by sigma. So here mu is 50 and sigma equals 10. Therefore, when you take x minus mu by sigma will be between the value 40, because x will take two different range. One is 45, the other one is 60. Therefore, 45 minus 50 divided by 10 and 60 minus 50 divided by 10. Therefore, the probability that you come across here is z being greater than minus 0.5 and less than 1. Z being greater than minus 0.5 and less than 1. So here, you can see here, this is the curve that you get, where 0 is the mean is 0 here. Now you need to find out the probability between 1 and minus 0.5. That is what you have seen earlier. So probability of z being greater than minus 0.5 and less than 1. So therefore, we will add up the two sections here. One is between 0 to minus 0.5. The other one is between 1 and 0. So z being less than 0 and greater than minus 0.5. And z being greater than 0 and less than 1. So these two probabilities we find out. And then we add up the two to give probability of z being greater than minus 0.5 and less than 1. So how to do that? So here we normally use a normal table, which you will get in any textbooks if you take. So the normal table, in the normal table you can see probability of z being greater than 0 and less than 0.5 can be found here in the normal table, where z is the value you can see here in normal table. So range of z will be given in vertical direction. So here z being between greater than 0 and less than 0.5, so 0.5 is here. So here you can see 0.1915 is the value which you take. So this table gives the probability of p of z greater than 0 less than z. So first column gives integer plus first decimal, top row equals second decimal place. So therefore the probability, when you find out, see, for 0.5 it is 0.1915, for 1 it is 0.3413. So you take these two different values and then you add up the two so that you get 0.5327. So the probability time is between 45 and 60 minutes will be equal to 0.5327. So this is how you calculate the normal distribution, or the solution for standard normal distribution that we come across within any examples that you take. So normally using a normal table is what you people should learn. So if you say p of 0.9 and 1.9, what is z greater than 0.19 and less than 0.1.9? So here you should divide this probability into two different parts. One is z being greater than 0 and less than 1.9. The other one is z being greater than 0 and less than 0.9. So you have two areas here. One is this white part what you can see here. The other one is this red part what you can see here. You have two different areas and you are going to subtract the two. So between 0 to 1.9 and between 0 to 0.9. So you want to find out this red part. So if I want to find out this red part, 0 to 1.9 is considered. 0 to 0.9 is considered. When you subtract these two, then only you get this particular red color curve. Means you get probability normal distribution function for this particular area between 0.9 to 1.9. So very simple, right? So by looking into the normal probability table, you find out what is the z greater than 0 and less than 1.9. So if you go back to the table, where is 1.9? I'm sorry, the table is not mentioned with 1.9. Further, you have 1.9 values below this table. So if you go to the table, look into the value where z is 1.9 and take that value, which is 0.4713, what you get. Again, you go to the value 0.9. So let me look, we have 0.9. Yeah, 0.9 is there, which is 0.3159. So you take 0.3159 there, so that is what 0.3159 you have taken here. Subtract that 2, you get 0.1554. This 0.1554 is the normal standard normal distribution that you can get for z being greater than 0.9 and less than 1.9. So I hope you got this solution, right? So if you want to find out any probability of z being greater than some value and less than some other value, you are going to distribute, or you are going to separate it with two different probabilities. And then using the normal table, you find out the value for those probabilities for two different values. And further, you either add it up or you subtract it based on the curves that you actually finding out, you need to find out. And finally, you get the result. Okay, thank you. So let us discuss about uniform distribution and further in the next video.